and welcome back to the Movie Marketing and Distribution Podcast powered by UsherU. My name is Alex Stoltz, and as well as hosting this show, I'm head of film here at UsherU and run a company called Future of Film. At UsherU, we are passionate about this very topic of movie marketing and distribution, and everything we do is driven by a mission to make marketing and distribution easier, more cost-effective and impactful. And if you want to check out all of our solutions for distributors and national film organizations, just head over to our website, which is usheru.com, which sounds simple until you realize you don't know how usheru is spelled. It's USHERU, usheru.com. And the name derives from ushers in movie theaters, of course, and that's an apt link for today's conversation. So exhibition has been on a rocky road the past few years is an understatement. The pandemic, lockdowns have been followed by a dramatically changed and slimmed down release calendar and schedule. Streaming, of course, has taken hold of the agenda. Many of the major studios are now incentivized to get their movies and get their content onto their platform sooner. And that's having a big knock-on effect, or has had a big knock-on effect for cinemas. And of course, now in the UK, at least, there's a cost of living crisis that is pinching cinemas, both at the consumer end, they got less money to spend on entertainment, perhaps. And of course, the cost of the overhead of running a big building with heating and energy is going up as well. So there's so many challenges. But if anyone can take the pulse of exhibition at the moment to see the wood through the trees, if you like, at least in the US, it's my guest today, Thaddeus Bouchard. Thaddeus is president of Screendollars, the multi-channel platform and enterprise with a mission to provide movie theaters with programs that drive revenue and profitability, including an extensive screen advertising program. The Screendollars newsletter has been going from strength to strength. It reports on all of the industry trends and news and distribution and exhibition, and it goes out to a regular audience of over 200,000 in the US alone. I'm really looking forward to this conversation. Thaddeus, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Alex. It's a delight to be invited. Thanks for the invitation.
I'd love it if you could start, please. Just tell us a bit more about Screendollars and your story. How did you end up become the president of the company?
So Screendollars is a business that my father started back in 1972. So it's a family business, or it began as a family business. And as you referenced just a minute ago, the kind of a core, you know, value even back in its inception was to work with exhibitors as a service provider and partner to provide a cinema advertising program. Basically, back in that period of time, it was slides that would, you know, sort of play either before the movie for indoor theaters or during the intermission at a drive-in movie theater, back in the era when drive-in movie theaters were much more kind of prevalent than they are currently. So we would work with my dad and the business at its inception would work with local exhibitors in the communities around where, you know, he was based, to represent them in their communities to businesses and potential advertisers and actual advertisers who would represent their businesses on screen at the movie theater or at the drive-in. So it was to facilitate a connection between the exhibitor and the community, and all around generating revenue and generating income for the exhibitor, which of course helps them with their bottom line. So that's sort of where the business comes from originally. And it's still quite an important part of our business. It's transformed multiple times over the decades since it began. But there is still a very important role in this sort of ecosystem of exhibition for marketing and promotion and advertising and the revenues that can come from that to help the exhibitor with their bottom line. So, you know, we have these days, you know, so many things have happened, but we have exhibitors all around the U.S. where that part of our business is very much U.S. focused. and in, you know, there's 50 states in the U.S., and we have exhibitors in 47 of those states. So, and just over 1,000 screens. So that's the kind of cinema advertising history of the business, anyways.
And our business has obviously evolved a lot. I remember you saying that previously there wasn't a lot of screen advertising when. Going back into the history and the, you know, the 1970s, it was quite a new concept then.
Well, it was very much a new concept, particularly in the US. In Europe, there were, and obviously still are, cinema advertising sort of activities that have gone on for many, many, many years. But in the US, there was this sense that advertising doesn't belong at the movie theater, which seems ironic these days. But so that was sort of a place for movies and only movies. The very first exhibitors that began to introduce advertising as part of the mix were drive-in movie theaters, as I referenced a minute ago. So this is back in a period of time where there were thousands of drive-ins across the United States in all kinds of, you know, different settings, both urban, but particularly sort of outside of the urban centers. And, you know, they would have double features. They would sell concessions. That was a big part of their business, right? And they would, you know, have oftentimes double features. And in the intermission period between the feature one and feature two, they would have a very active sort of kind of commerce that would be going on around the at the drive-in. And that commerce was both concessions and advertising. And it became a very important part of kind of the financial model for drive-in movie theaters. And it's, again, somewhat interesting because, you know, decades later, that's all coming full circle now, because doing more than just showing a movie at the movie theater is becoming a very important part of how exhibitors feel the future of exhibition is going to evolve from this point forward, with all the different entertainment options that are available or becoming available at many movie theaters. But drive-ins were the originator of the world of cinema advertising. And then in the 80s, mid-80s, late-80s, some indoor theaters, what sometimes are referred to as hard tops, would begin to experiment with a pre-show advertising program. So before the trailers, and, you know, there'd be some theater branding sometimes that would be slides up on the screen. And obviously before the feature, there would be a pre-show, what's referred to as a pre-show, and that's still what it's called. And advertising content would be represented in the pre-show. And these were all, you know, local businesses that would provide that service in and around the communities where the independent theaters were based. And then, you know, at a certain point, what wound up happening is that national kind of advertising organizations started to form and become involved in that business. And the advertising then that they would oftentimes focus on would be national consumer brands, kind of Fortune 500 companies who would have, you know, a consumer business that would want to promote their various brands. So the same sorts of advertising that at that time you might, you know, think of as being national ads on television would wind up showing up at the movie theater as well as part of the pre-show. So in our world of cinema advertising, there's these different streams of content. There's local content and there's national content. And so the national advertising folks started to form. Screen Vision is a partner that we work very closely with and did back even in from the mid 90s. And then National Cinemedia is another very large kind of cinema advertising provider that tends to serve the very largest circuits and chains. And those are the two primary providers for that in the US. You know, but there are other providers all around the world. Val Morgan is another very well-known, you know, advertising provider that's based in Australia, and others in different parts of the world. So
it's a important and under-known, I guess, part of the history of cinemas. And I'd never heard that term before, which I love, hard tops. which is brilliant. I'll start referring to all the cinemas now as hard tops. Thaddeus, that's really interesting. But obviously, as Screendollars is evolving as well, you have this incredible newsletter and a platform now where you're sharing a lot of information with the exhibition community. Yeah, tell us a bit more about that, because that seems like that's a that's a very a different, you know, sort of, sure. Well, not, it's a new part of the business.
So let me describe how we got from there to here, right? From sort of how we expanded, basically, is what it comes down to. As we expanded our kind of core business that I just was describing, we began to have, you know, literally hundreds of exhibitors who were regular customer exhibitor partners whom we were working with. And what, you know, I felt I wanted to add to those, to that relationship, was more value wherever we could in order to enhance our relationship with those exhibitors. So, you know, and a way to do that, or a way that seemed like it was an opportunity for us, was to begin to publish a newsletter. You know, we brought some sort of team members into the fold here at Screendollars who had a history of publishing information that would come from the studios about the upcoming film calendar. And of course, exhibitors play movies, so they're very interested in the upcoming film calendar and all of the different kind of details around which studio or distributor is putting out what titles in what, you know, schedule, all the bits and pieces about each and every movie, the rating and the runtime and the technical formats and promotion, you know, production budgets, so that they could sort of plan, you know, what to expect from that movie, box office forecasting, things like that. So we began to publish an email newsletter, because that was the most straightforward way to get started, to our existing exhibitor customers. So in our first, you know, couple months of doing this, which is about 6 years ago now, we had a couple hundred folks that we would send this to. And we sort of worked on that for a little while, back and forth, getting feedback from our exhibitor partners about where they were finding the information to be valuable and what was potentially less interesting. And we tuned it, and then we started to expand it. And this is all in the pre-pandemic days. And but the feedback we got was very positive. So we started to kind of promote it much more broadly to exhibitors in general, not just our cinema advertising partners. And then beyond that, we expanded our content ideas a little bit more in such a way that it was not just an exhibition newsletter, but it was an industry newsletter. So there's lots and lots and lots of people from the major studios and distributors, vendors who sell products in the industry, analysts, whoever tracks the industry from whatever perspective they track it. Everyone's always interested in the film calendar and the box office. So a real core part of the information that we provide in our newsletter, and I'll also mention our website here in a second too, is really focused around this sort of film calendar, film content, and everything that surrounds the upcoming film calendar. So,
yeah.
So, you know, we've got, you know, excellent feedback, and we've expanded it at the levels that you mentioned, actually. So,
yeah, amazing. Yeah, no, I've always. I mean, you talk about it being just for the industry, or up to this point, mainly focused on the industry. But I was always struck when I've spent time in the States, that box office, at least it used to be anyway, I don't know if it's still the same, is actually a consumer news story. So which is not something we used to hear in Europe. That's really fascinating. And then you're obviously, you know, creating this, all of this, providing all of this information for the industry, for exhibitors. Uh-huh. Where, I guess, you know, it'd be good to sort of talk about, you know, where you see that, what are they interested in at the moment? What are their concerns? What are the hopes and dreams of exhibition? I know you were recently in CinemaCon in uh-huh. Vegas, which is, it's a great kind of, bellwether, I guess, of where the industry is and how it's feeling. What was your impression when you attended?
To maybe respond to your question specifically, and then to zoom out a little bit beyond that, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that I think everyone, it was a very positive, particularly compared to the last several years of industry gatherings, it was a very positive vibe at CinemaCon this year, which is only a couple weeks ago now. So, you know, there is a sense that the box office is in fact coming back. And why is the box office coming back? Well, there's sort of the sort of lingering after effects of COVID, and people's anxiety around going to public places, you know, is sort of almost completely behind us at this point. So that's good, because a year ago, that was still very much not the case. But that's definitely the case. People generally accept that if I feel like going to the movie theater, there's nothing holding me back from going to the movie theater. So that's sort of one thing. The studio, these things all kind of support each other and all are interrelated. The studio, the volume and variety of studio theatrical releases is significantly greater than it was 6 months ago, even, let alone a year or a year and a half or 2 years ago. So there's a lot of optimism that the studios are delivering the product to theaters that they have not, that they've been sort of less inclined to deliver over the last several years. So, you know, if you don't have product, as they say in the industry, right, the movies are the product. If you don't have product, then, you know, you really don't have much of a business. So there's a lot more product and a lot more desirable and interesting product. And whereas a movie like Top Gun, for instance, Top Gun Maverick last year, that was so very successful, seemed like, you know, it was a delightful surprise and success for the industry in general, for exhibitors specifically. But it still felt at that time a year ago like that was possibly a one-off, or that was a unicorn, maybe as a way to put it, not necessarily a one-off, but a very unusual event. And it was unusual in some ways. But now we've had a kind of a year of, you know, pretty consistent performance from, you know, some interesting films along the way. So it doesn't seem like it's sort of very unusual that there would be a very successful film or series of films over the course of a month, for instance, or a quarter that would be coming out. So that creates this much more sort of generally positive feeling about where the industry is at. And you know, I'm sort of speaking for and on behalf of exhibitors here in that comment, but not uniquely so. Because I think that studios are kind of, from their point of view, reconsidering, as they should, what their future is. And whereas during the height of the pandemic, and even in the lead up to the pandemic, the sort of year or two leading up to the pandemic, there was a lot of thought that, you know, the growth in the industry was all going to come from streaming. So therefore, the major players on the studio side needed to invest in their streaming strategy and create their streaming strategy and poured lots and lots of resources into getting market share. You know, there's a big reconsideration of that now for bottom line reasons. You know, it's now a highly competitive environment, and the cost and revenue equation is really being actively reconsidered. And obviously, these are, you know, common stories that are written about all the time in the industry. So, so studios with under that pressure and seeing that, you know, streaming is not, you know, the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow necessarily. It's a very important part of the mix, but it's only part of the mix, and it comes with its pros and cons. I think it's caused studios to sort of reconsider the role of theatrical releasing and the role of exhibition in their future. Not just sort of their past, but in their future. And I think that, you know, at CinemaCon, to come back to your question then, Alex, at CinemaCon, I think there was a pretty widespread appreciation for the unique role going forward that exhibitors have and that theatrical releasing has in the movie business. And so that positivity was just part of every conversation I had, basically. So there was a very good vibe there.
That's really great. So where now? Where, you know, with you know, now they've sort of gone through this process, what are the what are the hot topics for the community at the moment?
For the exhibition community specifically?
Yes, yeah. Specifically, yeah.
Sure. So there's relief that there's more product, as I said, and that the outlook going forward is that will continue or maybe even improve. I mean, you know, there's announcements from, you know, Apple and Amazon of, you know, major $1 billion a year investments to create films targeted for initial release to theaters, you know, so sort of a theatrical distribution from these, you know, obviously extremely sort of wealthy and well-resourced organizations that are trying to build out their future businesses as well. So there's, you know, positivity about that. So there's relief from exhibitors that is the outlook. Beyond that, though, the challenges are numerous for exhibitors. You referenced it once again at the very beginning of our discussion here, Alex, is that running a movie theater, operating a movie theater is a very expensive proposition. The price of utilities, electricity, keeps growing. The price of running a physical operation of the size of a movie theater keeps expanding. The cost of staffing is significant and growing, as well as wages increase, from the exhibitor's point of view, from the business's point of view. And then you've got all of the sort of technical and physical investment in the facility that is necessary. Sometimes landlords, if it is an operation, which the exhibitor doesn't own the building, but they're leasing the building from a landlord, there's, been forever these negotiations and sort of agreements that are better, sometimes not as, who has the power in that relationship? But there's a lot of physical investment to create a movie theater going experience, a movie going experience for consumers that just keeps increasing. There's a sort of increases. There's wonderfully so there are opportunities, but it's a double-edged sword. Wonderfully so there are opportunities to provide that much more of a brighter and more impressive presentation of the movie on screen in these auditoriums, laser projection, Dolby sound, enhanced audio experiences. The type of screen that does best in the current environment and going forward is a premium large format screen. So think IMAX and think the big wow factor type presentations. Those are extremely expensive auditoriums to put together and to operate and to maintain and to keep up to speed with the latest technologies as they come along. And the scale and speed of technological enhancement or building out the capabilities from a kind of physical point of view, it just keeps getting faster and faster. So whereas 10 years ago, 12 years ago, 15 years ago, when it was that period when 35 millimeter film was going away, digital cinema was coming in, and it took 5, 7, 8, 10 years in order for the industry to make that transition. Now these transitions happen every 2, 3, 4 years, but there's a huge capital requirement in order to get your theater to take advantage of those things. And where's that money going to come from? Well, hopefully it comes from the box office. It comes from the revenue that your business is generating. But another challenge on top of that is to the extent that you are a business and you're going to borrow money to make a capital investment in your business, first of all, you and your lenders want to know what the future is 5 years out, 10 years out. So you have to sort of be able to project that. A lot of the people who track our website and our newsletter really analyze the industry from that point of view, is what is the long-term outlook for this industry? Because they're making financial investment decisions based on that, which is interesting. So that's just showing the movie on a screen. But in order for the overall, which will come all the way back to cinema advertising as one piece, in order for the overall business bottom line to make sense and to be a well-planned out and a stable long-term business, what many exhibitors are investing in and finding that they need to invest in is to bring in additional revenue streams beyond the box office. What are those additional revenue streams? Those additional revenue streams can be advertising. One of the nice things about advertising is it leverages all the equipment and technology that you have in place to show the movie. So it isn't an incremental investment that you have to make to tap into that revenue. You've already made the investment. You just sort of get it by kind of putting this additional content through the pipes that you already have, so to speak. But now there are other areas around turning the movie theater into a place where you can have beer and wine, which was not always the case, especially in the US, where you can have enhanced concessions all the way to kind of full in-theater dining and everything in between, that would go in between these areas. So those extremes, I should say. Bowling and arcades and sports bars and sort of turning the movie theater into an entertainment destination, axe throwing, darts and, just turning it into a pub and an entertainment center. And exhibitors are playing around with these ideas. Different exhibitors are approaching it in different ways, depending on what their intuitions are, what their background and experience is. There's a lot of creativity, actually, in exhibition right now around experimenting with how best to expand their business, to take advantage of the audience that they have and the role they have as a place of entertainment in the community, but to do these additional things, because that then taps, if it's done well and successfully, taps into additional revenue streams. And the exhibitors that are doing the best in the current market, and I anticipate going forward, are successful in figuring that out. Because just sort of show and movie, opening the doors and show and movies and thanks, you know, see you next week. That's a difficult business going forward, I think. So,
yeah. Yeah, it's really interesting. So it's about that experience and giving people a reason to get out, yeah, get off the couch. And
well, that's a big part of the competition, right? A big part of the competition is the couch. And that experience is getting better too. So they have to compete with, at-home movie viewing or embrace it somehow, you know, be part of it somehow. This is another project that we're working on. I can't even recall if in our prior conversations I've mentioned this, but you know, we are partnering with a company called Row 8 to bring to exhibitors a video on demand offering that they can offer their customers, so that exhibitors can at the same time be presenting their in-theater movie experience and an at-home movie experience, to kind of try to assume this role as your preferred purveyor of Hollywood, right, of the movies. You know, if you want to interact with the movies, you can do it in your relationship that you have with your local theater. And those are interesting opportunities as well. We'll see how streaming and exhibition somehow coexist and maybe in some ways complement each other. You know, if you think about it from a consumer's point of view, you know, I just like movies. So I just want to watch movies. And, you know, if you have different options to watch them at home, which is obviously the way it is now, than to watch them in the theater, those are very, from the business's point of view, those are very separated things. But from the consumer's point of view, it's just one continuity. It's just, I like movies.
You're listening to the Movie Marketing and Distribution Podcast, powered by UsherU. How is your marketing strategy right now? Are there areas you want to improve? Or perhaps you are looking for some fresh inspiration and ideas on how to remain ahead of the curve? Well, the UsherU Marketing Scorecard is a completely free resource to identify your marketing strengths and opportunities in less than 5 minutes. Head over to scorecard.usheru.com. And you'll receive a personalized report on your marketing, what's working well, areas of improvement, and quick wins. So that's scorecard.usheru.com. Score your marketing today with UsherU at scorecard.usheru.com. And now back to the show. Interesting. I think it's also playing on the exhibitor's brand and that relationship they have with the consumer, and saying, look, we can provide a sort of almost 360 experience for you. And so I think it's a really interesting play. And I think I agree with you, for what it's worth. It's those exhibitors who, it's innovation. It's needed, isn't it? It's really thinking outside the box and bringing in different ways to build that relationship with a customer.
Sure. Walmart used to sell, you know, boxes of things, and now they're the single biggest grocery chain in the United States, but they didn't used to do groceries, but they had those customer relationships. So how can they increase the range of things that they provide to their customers? And they decided that grocery was an opportunity, and now they're the biggest grocer in the United States. And obviously you could go into all the Amazon stories of how they're expanding their business to provide you know, why is Amazon in the entertainment business or the video business? They were a bookstore and an online product seller, but they decided that they wanted to expand what they do. You know, in the world of exhibitors, exhibitors, although some of them are quite large businesses, they're starting from a different point of view. They're not an Amazon and they're not a Walmart. They're something else. But the logical extension is they're an entertainment vendor, right? They provide entertainment. That's what they do. So if they can expand their entertainment offerings to be dining and bowling and you know, at-home entertainment as well as at the theater entertainment, then those are their expansion opportunities, it seems to me. So.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Are there any exhibitors you'd like to name drop who you feel are doing a particularly great job of this at the moment?
Sure. There's many kind of towards the high end of the industry. A theater chain that we do a lot of work with is B&B Theaters. B&B Theaters is, I think, the fifth biggest exhibitor in North America. And they expanded over the course of the pandemic very significantly. I don't know exactly what the percentage is, but I think they probably have 25% more screens than they did at the start of the pandemic now. They took over a lot of operations from exhibitors that for one reason or another were sort of stepping back. And when they go into a location, they turn it into, at the very sort of minimum, they turn it into a movie theater that has, you know, the best projection and the best, you know, recliner seats and the best sound and, you know, very consistent high-end concessions offerings. But then in some locations, increasingly, they're getting into these other entertainment options, offering those at the theaters. It depends on the physical setting as to whether or not it's appropriate for them to do and what their landlord relationship is if they don't actually own the building. But increasingly, what they're trying to do is to provide those types of services. So they're a pretty big chain. I think they have 55 locations or something. And they said, you know, now's the time. Now's the time to expand our business. There's sort of turbulence in the industry, but there is a path forward that they felt very, you know, that they put their finger on and they felt committed to. They were able to and had the resources to be able to make those investments. And it's like, this is when we need to make those investments, because if we don't make it now, we're going to be struggling 5 years from now, not having made them. So they're definitely a good one. You know, there's an exhibitor in Texas called Shulman Theaters. It's a 6-location, small little regional chain, family business. Morris Shulman is the owner there. They're also, they've sort of rebranded these sort of entertainment complexes that they have, which is half of those 6 locations. So 3 of them as Film Alley. And Film Alley has bowling and arcade and all kinds of entertainment options. Texas is a particularly strong market for exhibition for a lot of different reasons. So they're killing it. You know, I visited them 9 months ago or 10 or 12 months ago. Top Gun was 10 months ago. Top Gun was in their theaters at the time, Top Gun Maverick. And the owner said, you know, this is the busiest, you know, period that we've ever had in our entire business right now. The sort of 4 weeks before and the next 4 weeks to come will be the busiest 8-week stretch in the history of the company. And it's a company that's been around for 50 years. So if you have the right product, then, you know, people want to get out. I mean, again, this is something that you mentioned earlier, Alex, but the people really do want to get out and enjoy entertainment. I think that there is still, even to some extent, this sort of post-pandemic kind of sort of pent up demand to experience the world and, you know, to experience the world at the movie theater. It's an interesting opportunity. It's been, if you go back to the 20s and 30s, you know, movie consumers would experience the world at the movie theater. There was no television, there was radio, you know, this is like way, way back history of Hollywood type stuff. But that was how you experienced a wider world as you went to the movie theater. And, you know, to the extent that, and there's other options, you know, there's the internet and there's, you know, just a million different ways to experience the world, your phone, you know, whatever. But if you want to sort of get out of the house and you want to experience the world, but do it, that it only takes 3 hours to do it, you know, the movie theater is a pretty good option, remains a pretty good option to do that. So with COVID, you know, there was this huge, you know, kind of kind of being cooped up feeling that everyone was experiencing. And I think people are still kind of eager to have those experiences. That's why travel is so popular now, has become so popular once again, is that I got to get out. I got to go somewhere. I got to go on a vacation. I got to do something. And, you know, and that this one guy, Morris Schulman, he was saying, you know, the people who are coming to our movie theater, they want the lobster and the steak. And, you know, they want it all because they are just ready to go, ready to enjoy themselves. And I do feel that that is what's going on in society, I suppose, in the culture right now. So.
That sounds very Texas, though. The lobster and the steak.
Right. Yes, I think so, too.
do it big there. I'd like to bring you back to a word you used a few times at the beginning of a conversation, Thaddeus, community. You talked about your father bringing the community with the theatre together to showcase, you know, products and services relevant to them. Community and the exhibition sector. Well, do you feel like that's an opportunity that could be, you know, reignited a bit more? Do you feel like exhibitors still can be part of a community if they're not, I guess, based in a town centre? I think that might be one of the big changes since that time. But yeah, just interested if you had any thoughts on that topic.
So in our cinema advertising business, the part of the exhibition world that we particularly focus on are smaller independent theaters. So we have hundreds of examples of theaters that we work with who are in that profile. And so we see, ones that are more successful and less successful. And a big part of being successful as a small independent theater is how you engage with the community that you're located in, how you are viewed as an asset to the community, basically, and as sort of a kind of like a focal point for enjoying yourself and having fun, whether it's as families, you know, taking the kids to the movies, or it's date night, or it's, you know, whatever it is. If sort of that local theater feels like it's connected with the community, and the community feels like they're connected with it, then those are, you know, more successful theaters than the ones that are not. So how do you accomplish that in the modern day, right? I think that a kind of use of, there's a lot of ways, but one of them is the use of social media, because social media is around community. There's a significant overlap between the two. I mean, social media is global, and there's all kinds of things going on social media, but part of what goes on social media are these kind of community focal points. And I think if a theater that is active on social media, that has a good distribution that they're reaching in that way, that is creative about what they post and what they're promoting, not just the movies, although absolutely promote the movies, but is promoting, you know, discount nights and, you know, ladies' night and family events and special film calendars and, you know, film series. Those things really matter versus not doing that. Because if you don't do that, you're just this sort of box that sits on a piece of land somewhere, and people either come to it or not. But the only reason to go to it is because you want it. The only reason to go to it, which is an important one, is, you know, Top Gun just came out, or Avatar just came out, or, you know, Super Mario just came out. And that, of course, is the foundation of it all. But if you have these other dimensions to what you do as a business and how you interact with the community, then you're a much more vibrant place. There were some theaters during the pandemic that did kind of GoFundMe type of campaigns to sort of keep the lights on, or keep the staff employed, or keep the staff employed with health insurance during the pandemic, for instance. So they felt, and the community felt reciprocally a connection with each other, and that's important. Another thing that I'll mention just comes to mind as we're talking about it is during the period of time where there was a lot of kind of debate or discussion around the movie theaters having been forced to close for COVID, and then operating in sort of these partial ways, even when they weren't completely closed. A lot of the discussion within the U.S. federal government around the disaster relief funds that ultimately were sort of voted for and distributed was about the role of movie theaters in their communities. That was the reason, or a big part of the justification, at least from a political point of view, as to why it was worthwhile to make that investment as the government. And of course, it's not just in the U.S., it's all around the world that those discussions were taking place. And I believe that's true. And you know, another thing is that people like stories. And that was a good story. And that doesn't mean it was an inaccurate story, but it was a story. It sort of touched on the kind of human connection that people have with their movie theater in that case, or with their community even more generally. And it was an important part of keeping those businesses operating and keeping those locations operating for the communities that they're based in. So, I mean, I love these stories about these sort of small kind of traditional exhibitors and what they do in their communities. You know, another thing that that I've observed hundreds of times is oftentimes these small independent exhibitors, they are, you know, like the mayor of the town or the guy who runs the auto parts store who picked up the movie theater when it was for sale because he's always loved the movies, but now he's running it as a business. Or there was a guy in Florida as a customer of ours that used to run an arcade business with putting arcade games in all kinds of different venues, public venues. And one of his customers was the movie theater, and the movie theater was up for sale. So he bought the movie theater, and now it's this movie theater arcade thing. But, you know, in addition to being a location for entertainment, it's also a big employer, particularly of the youth, the teenagers of the town. This is where, you know, teenagers get their first jobs. This is where they learn about customer service in a sort of simple, straightforward way. They're interacting with other people in their towns. So it's a community service from that point of view as well, because it's an employer in the town. And that was another aspect that was talked about very much when the disaster relief funds were being kind of discussed politically at the height of COVID, is that, you know, these are businesses that the town is kind of focused on. And if you take those businesses out of the town, then you're really doing damage to the town. So,
yeah. It's much more, I think, than just showing the films is the conclusion here. And it's all of those elements. And yeah, it's really fascinating to hear this perspective, Thaddeus. I'd like to just wrap things up by asking about Screendollars and the next step. You've built this big audience and this platform and these and this huge following on the newsletter. Yeah, where do you see things going now?
Well, there's a few things in the world of our sort of publications, right? You know, in our core business, we want to continue doing what we're doing and expand it and be successful in just having more relationships with more exhibitors to provide that service that we provide. In our publishing world, you know, we're shortly going to be introducing on our website an ability to access more advanced film data and film analytics that will allow people who kind of are really kind of at the core of the industry, who worry about these things, to get more information that will help them make decisions around the film calendar, forecasts, box office opportunities, scheduling, you know, sort of film date, you know, scheduling and things like that. So kind of whether it's on the studio side or the exhibitor side or the finance side or vendors who sell in the industry, you know, getting more access to more information. So that's sort of something we're investing a lot of our energy into from a development perspective and data gathering and representation. Beyond that, on our website, you know, we feel that there is an opportunity to have it begin to have a dimension to it which appeals to movie consumers. Because all of the video and the image and the information that we have can be kind of packaged in a way that we feel that it will be of interest to people who just are movie fans and like to follow the stars. You know, we have talent pages on our website, for instance, that we've just begun to introduce with original biographies of actors and filmmakers. So that's intended to be of interest to people who work in the movie business because they're movie fans too, right? by and large. But it has an appeal that goes outside of the industry professional, so that we can, you know, wind up having a bigger and bigger movie-focused audience that we bring to our site. So, so those are a couple areas where we're making big investments.
Yeah, that's really exciting. Of course, Usher U and data and analytics, that's something we'd love to talk to you more about. And yeah, it makes so much sense. You know, we got the, you know, people are fascinated about the industry side, I think, consumers. And I think, and of course, you know, got all this great content. So if you can provide a space where we consumers are, you know, involved and engaged, and, you know, in a way to also cross that over to exhibition, to your partners, that sounds amazing. But look, it's been fantastic talking to you. Thank you for taking the time and sharing all the insights.
Yeah, it's my pleasure.
Where do people find out more about you and Screendollars?
Screendollars.com is our website. So that would be a good place to start. And then we try to have a busy, active homepage with all kinds of news of the day and, you know, latest trailers and videos and things like that, the upcoming film calendar. So you should sort of probably start there, I would say. So sign up for our newsletter, which you can do on our homepage.
Perfect. Screendollars.com. Thank you. Thank you again, Thaddeus.
Okay, it's my pleasure. Thank you very much, Alex.
You've been listening to the Movie Marketing and Distribution Podcast, powered by UsherU. If you want to know more about how UsherU can transform your marketing and distribution, just head over to usheru.com, or why not drop me an email at alex@usheru.com. But in the meantime, thank you again for listening, and look forward to welcoming you back on the podcast very soon.